Hi everyone, and welcome to episode 2 of our video podcasts hosted by Desperate Writers. My name is Katya, and first of all I wanted to thank you all for your wonderful feedback on my first episode. If any of you has just tuned in and haven't seen the first episode, please follow the link below. Just to remind you, in this series we are talking about doctors, and not just doctors but fictional doctors, and not just fictional doctors but mostly doctors of the 19th century, although I would say that at a certain point I'll probably make some references to the doctors of the 21st century or 20th century as well. Today I will be talking about the folk roots and the mythological roots of fictional doctors, and I will mostly be referring to Russian culture and Russian history. However, many of my observations can also be applied to the European history and literature as well. Do you remember the first episode of our podcast? I talked a little bit about the scarcity of doctors in the early 19th century literature, and I mentioned the Victorian novels and how the critics really detested the fact that the doctor, the medical practitioner, could be made a leading character. If we look at Russian literature, we'll see a very similar picture. In the first half of the 19th century of Russian literature, we see some doctors involved in the plots, but they are never the protagonists. And in fact, if we look at the characters, at the set of characters that involved in the plots of stories, of the plays, of novels of Russian literature, we do not see too many professions involved. What does it mean? We don't see people who are actually characterized by their profession. So the characters could belong to different layers of the societies, like the aristocracy, they could be royal family, they could be peasants, they could be merchants, but they were not professionals, yes? And actually what I found out when I was doing my research is that the doctors were basically the first professionals that that infiltrated Russian literature. The only exceptions that could be called the professions are the so-called ritualized occupations. Like, for example, in the fairy tales, you will often encounter a miller or a blacksmith. But if you remember the fairy tales, you can say that these professions, like the miller or the blacksmith, they are mostly just just marking the status of this character, or sometimes they are just replacing his or her name. Yeah. So, for example, do you remember this fairy tale? There was a miller whose only inheritance to his three sons was his mill, his donkey, and his cat. The division was soon made. They hired neither a clerk nor an attorney, for they would have eaten up all the poor patrimony. The eldest took the mill, the second took the donkey, and the youngest nothing but the cat. Yeah, so that's, of course, it's Charles Perrault's Puss in Boots. Or also the tale starts, in a land far from here, there lived an old miller who had a young daughter. Yes, and that's the Rumpelstiltskin tale. Many tales, they start with this, with the miller who is somehow involved in the plot. Another set of professions that we have in literature and also in folklore are the professions that are associated with certain points in life that every human passes through, and namely these are the figures of the undertaker or the gravedigger and respectively the midwife. Yeah, so both of those professions, they belong to the number of ritualized and magical occupations, because they are linked to the key moments in life that in traditional culture are marked by a variety of rituals. And in any culture, as we know, birth and death is surrounded with a vast amount of rituals and beliefs, and we can still find their traces even in our times. Yeah, good examples of this clash between the old times, old beliefs, and the new or rational, more materialist culture. You can see it in Bulgakov's, Mikhail Bulgakov's A Country Doctor's Notebook. That's an excellent book. If you haven't read it, I really recommend you to take a look at this. So Mikhail Bulgakov was one of the very famous Russian novelists, but he started as a doctor, and he actually worked as a country doctor in the beginning of the 20th century, which is quite late, you know, because, you know, that's already after the 19th century, after the time when medicine made a giant leap, you know, both in Europe and especially in Russia. But he was working in this very distant Russian country hospital, and where nothing really has changed. And in one of those stories, which happens on the December 9th, the young doctor, who is a protagonist, chats with his staff, his assistant, and a couple of midwives, who are older than him and much more experienced than he is. And they tell him stories of how the common beliefs and superstitions got into the way of medicine, especially when they are talking about labor, of course. So, for example, one of the midwives says, "When a woman in labor, they give her hair to chew," said Anna Nikolaevna. "What on earth for? God alone knows. I've had three confinements where the wretched woman was lying there and spitting something out. Her mouth was full of hair or bristles. Apparently they believe it makes for an easier birth." For the author, for the narrator, this is an example of peasant superstitions and their ignorance. Yeah, so that's why this chapter is called Black as Egypt's Night. However, I think that in this particular example, we see a clash between two cultures, two major basic ideologies. So, which is, of course, the positive knowledge, the materialist science, versus the traditional and old beliefs. And that's actually how people in Russia, and especially in villages, lived for hundreds of years. And just to give you another example of how closely related are a midwife and an undertaker in the eyes of the common consciousness of culture, I would like to talk a little bit about a half humorous, half philosophical sketch which was published in one of Russian literary journals called Telescope in 1833. And it hosts a midwife and an undertaker, a gravedigger, under one roof. And this text ironically implies that this little gray house symbolizes life from beginning to end. A series of amusing scenes show different situations in which the services of undertaker and the midwife are always confused, prompting the reader to muse on the ultimate proximity of those professions. These professionals symbolized and are incorporated into the rituals of the circle of life. Not accidentally, the sketch is concluded with an apocalyptic scene in which the gravedigger and the midwife turn out to be the last people on earth. The only reason they are still alive is their magical association with the starting and ending points of human lives. The doctor joins this set of professions, like, you know, midwife and gravedigger, but unlike the midwife or the gravedigger, which are the ancient professions, they existed for many centuries. Doctors were literally foreign to the majority of Russian people, because prior to the reforms of Peter the Great, only the Tsar and his family were able to get a real medical assistance. And what Peter the Great did, first of all, he started sending young Russians abroad so that they could learn different trades, including medicine. But he also started bringing the foreign professionals from abroad, so from Germany, from England, from Holland, and so on. Yeah, so and that's why actually the if you look at Russian literature, like for example the Inspector General by Nikolai Gogol, you have this figure of a doctor, of German doctor, who doesn't know any Russian, he doesn't speak any Russian. Yes, and he just, you know, has this sound that he makes, like nothing else. So that's even though, you of course, this play is a satire, this actually reflects the actual situation, because many Russian doctors were ethnic Germans or ethnic Dutch, and many of them would just come from abroad and wouldn't speak any Russian. So there was a tradition of coming to Russia, and even though it was considered dangerous, it was also well paid, so many people would come there. Yeah. And since the majority of people in Russia, they would not they didn't even know about this figure of doctor. The doctor who was a foreigner, who had an accent, who was definitely an outsider, who was in doubt with some knowledge that they didn't understand, and had this scary looking tools, he often was considered as a sorcerer, and all his his art, his skills were considered a witchcraft. So similar to the gravedigger, the undertaker, and the midwife, the doctor and the gravedigger also act as a interchangeable duo, interchangeable pair of characters in the folk theater, appearing in as stock characters of the folk theater, of Russian folk theater, that was very popular in 17th, 18th, and 19th century. The plots of the plays that were staged by this theater, they were mostly taken from the European, again, street performances, and mostly were performed in in the form of puppet theater. So the example that I'm going to talk about is a very popular play called Tsar Maximilian. And in this play, the cast on stage is divided into two separate groups, one of which holds fixed roles, like, for example, the warrior fights, the Tsar orders, the messenger brings the characters to the Tsar, while the second group allows the roles and actions to be interchangeable. Yeah, like, for example, when the warrior dies, the gravedigger resurrects him by the smack. So he is not burying him, but he is actually saving him. And as a response, gets a slap from the revived warrior. Yeah, he falls down. He says, my head hurts. And then the doctor is summoned to cure the undertaker by his cane. And afterwards, he's chased away from the stage. Yeah. And in some versions of other plays, the doctor either kills the patient or himself gets killed by the protagonist. Yeah, so we see that the figures of the undertaker and the doctor, or the gravedigger and the doctor, they are interchangeable and they are very close. So the tradition, the traditional thinking, the traditional mentality, it's trying to insert the doctor into this set of this magical ritualized professions. Yeah, this Dr. Quack, he always introduces himself, and he implies that he's not from this country. He is from abroad. He traveled a lot, and again, this somehow it reflects the reality, because as I said, many doctors were foreigners, and in the 18th and also in the 19th century. And then he says, and that's actually the translation from Tsar Maximilian, I know how to cure, I know how to steal, I know how to fly, I know how to part people from this earth. I cut out healthy parts and put dead ones in their place. I do bloodletting, cure women, poke out the eyes. Yes. So the set of quality listed in this self-introduction later comes up in Russian literature. The common perception places doctors in the same on the same page with sorcerers, demons, and wizards, with abilities that would include flying, curing people, or parting patients with this earth, with this world. The redundancy of traits of the quack is split into different types of doctors that would include gifted professionals who could easily cure all diseases, villains who could abuse their power and hurt the patients, and quacks who would just pretend to be skilled physicians. Yeah, so all of those. So in a nutshell, this again, this farce, this folk farce, contains future plots that we're going to see later in the 19th century. So I would like to stop right now, because I could talk for a long time, but I'll definitely come back to this topic of doctors as supernatural beings and doctors being endowed with some unusual and sometimes non-human skills. So we'll see what we are going to talk about next time. I don't know yet. I have to figure it out. But I hope that you've enjoyed this this episode. And as always, please feel free to give your feedback or to ask questions or leave comments. I'll be very happy to see them. And thank you so much for tuning in. And see you next time. Bye bye.